Hello, everyone. It is Swankivy, and today I'm doing a continuation of my ACE interview series, bringing people onto my channel who are going to have a chance to tell their stories, their personal narratives, and relieve everyone from having to just hear me talk all the time. So my guest today is Eric, and I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to him to let him introduce himself. Eric?
Okay. Hi. Glad to be on the interview today. It's really nice to meet you. I read your book, Invisible Orientation.
Oh, hey.
I loved it. Yes. Anyway, my name is Eric. I am one of the older aces, I guess you could say. I'm 42 years old and I live in Kentucky. I'm a software developer and I recently discovered asexuality 5 years ago at the age of 37. So once I started doing a little bit of research on that and kind of reading the forums and seeing all the experiences of other people, it really started to resonate with me. And I've been identifying as asexual since then. I also identify as aromantic.
Right.
So so that's basically it.
Great. Okay. Me too. Yeah. Okay. So like you said that you figured it out kind of from looking at forums and whatnot, but maybe if you could give us maybe a little more in-depth introduction to kind of what made you think that you wanted to look into this, kind of how did you come to that conclusion? What was it like?
Okay. Yeah. So it was kind of a long journey, but
we're 40 plus year olds, so
that's right. Yeah, so in my 20s or so, I started dating, and I would like date somebody. Mm-hmm. I'd have a great time, and then I would never want to see her again. Oh. And then I would date someone else and have a great time, and then I just wouldn't want to see her again. And this pattern continued for a very long time. Mm-hmm. I would take years off of, away from it, and then I would come back and like, all right, I should try this again. I tried a lot of dating sites, match.com, and then OkCupid was one. Mm-hmm. And then I had a friend of a friend who was playing matchmaker, and she set me up with somebody, and it just didn't fit, But the thing is, like, the weather that day was just perfect. It was, like, a gorgeous day. And I just had this idea in my mind. It's like, I don't think I ever want to date. Like, I think I'm perfectly happy single. And I don't feel like I need to find a partner anymore. It always just felt like a drudgery to me. Mm. So I actually ran into some books by Bella DePaulo called Singlism, I think it's called.
Oh.
And she talked about people who are single for life. But those people tend to still get a lot of sex, right? Now, I wasn't really worried about, it never really bothered me that, I never really cared about it that much. So then I started looking into, I think I went to the internet, I was like, what do you call somebody who doesn't want to have sex or whatever? And I think that led me to Aven.
Ah.
And then from there, I read their FAQ, their frequently asked questions. And I started reading the forums, and then I bought your book, read that, and I think that really convinced me is when I started kind of putting all the pieces together, and mm-hmm. that, yeah, this really fits. This description really fits for me.
Mm-hmm.
So along the way, there was aromanticism as well. Was just I don't know. I always dreaded I always thought, well, someday I'll get married, but I'm not going to worry about it now. And then it's like, well, maybe I should. I don't really want to. And I think I just realized a lot of the pressures I was feeling were external. These weren't desires coming from inside. This is society expects me to get married and do these things and have kids or whatever.
Yeah.
And, I really didn't actually want to do any of that. So,
No mm-hmm. intrinsic desire to do those things. You just thought it was time and it was expected.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think I think maybe the first layer of that onion was not wanting kids either. So it's like,
mm-hmm.
yeah, it was like one of those things that I guess I'm going to have kids someday, but
yeah.
So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I feel like that was, that's really recognizable to me. Cause when I was a kid, I was just like, of course I'm going to be somebody's wife and somebody's mom. Mm-hmm. I can't picture it, but I can't picture driving a car or being a grown up either. So I just figured eventually yeah. I would want to, and it never happened. Right. So that's really relatable.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. So kind of springboarding off of that, like, how do other people in your life, do you tell them about this, and have you told people about this, and how does that go with disclosure?
Yeah. So, I think I kind of bottled it up. Like, I kept it secret for about 6 months or so.
Oh.
And I was really nervous that somebody was going to find out, like, I was going to these forums or whatever. I'm not sure how they would have, but,
yeah.
you know, I was like, well, okay. And then one day I just decided to come out to a very close friend of mine. I actually invited him over for lunch.
Okay.
And I just said, hey, I am asexual, and here's what this means. He just listened, and he really understood what I was saying. He didn't judge me, I knew he was like he's a really cool guy, very open-minded. So,
mm-hmm.
So there, I was super nervous about just doing that. Right. So I told him about it. And then I think a few weeks after that, I finally got up the courage to go to Facebook and just, I typed up this really long post on Facebook, and I was so nervous, and I was like, I just got to do this. So I typed that up, hit enter, and then I just shut my computer off. I didn't turn the computer on the next day,
uh-huh.
you know, so I just wanted to take a break, uh-huh. but my mom called.
Oh.
So it was like, yeah, there you go. I didn't know the guts to tell you in person or even on the phone.
Wow.
But yeah, there it is. So in general, it's been really positive. I thought a lot of people would disbelieve me or thought maybe I was lying for some reason. But
mm-hmm.
I was surprised. The support was overwhelming. It was, you know, everybody's like, we're whatever makes you happy, that's great. I think I had one uncle who said, well, that's okay because St. Paul was celibate or something like that.
The St. Paul, yeah, I've heard that.
Or was it Paul or Peter? I can't remember if it was Paul or Peter.
Yeah.
Anyway, yeah.
Wow.
But other than that, it was really positive. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So do I go around just saying, hey, everybody, I'm asexual.
No, my t-shirt.
I don't. Like, I've got the purple dragon shirt. Well, yeah. Kind of yellow on here, but.
That's cool looking.
It's kind of covert. But then the ring as well.
Yeah, I was going to say, is that an ace ring?
Yeah. And hopefully it's not mirrored on, like, this is my right hand. So anyway, so it's kind of a covert thing. Like, you can wear it and other asexuals will know what it is.
Right.
Really knows. So, so I don't go around with like a billboard. Hey, I am asexual. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I wrote a book about it and I don't even do that.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think if a situation arose where maybe somebody thought I was leading them on, I might explain it or, but that hasn't really happened, so.
Right.
Yeah, not too worried about it, yeah.
Yeah. Well, on my list of things that I wanted to make sure I asked you, I think the next thing I want to talk about is dating stuff, but you already kind of touched on it. So I'm kind of curious, based on some of the things you said and also in this arena, so that I can address this question. Like, did you feel like aromanticism and asexuality was kind of you solved both those mysteries at the same time? Like, they're too bound up in each other for you?
Pretty close. Yeah, it was pretty close together. I guess I understood the aromantic side of it before because mm-hmm. I read that book. book by
the Singlism.
Yeah, which is a fine read, by the way.
Yeah, it sounds like something I might be interested in.
Yeah, check it out, Bella DePaulo. But okay. She presents a lot of data about like misconceptions about being single as opposed to married. So anyway, it's very interesting. One of the things people say are like married people are happier or whatever, right? So she actually debunks that in that book. Uh-huh. So yeah, definitely worth the read. But so I think I figured out the aromantic stuff first, and then maybe about a month later, I started looking into, you know, I think I read that book and read another book about being single, and then I started going into the, oh, well, maybe I'm also this, or, you know, why don't I care about sex either? So
right,
that's kind of where it went from there.
Right. Yeah. All of those things were kind of together, and also just like not feeling like you needed to have a partner to be complete, right?
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. Just nothing that you need in your life requires a partner.
That's right. Yeah. I'm pretty independent. So like I'm self-sustaining and
yeah,
I don't know. Like, but I understand people who are self-sustaining still want a partner, a romantic partner.
Sure. Takes all kinds, right?
Yeah.
So you said in your kind of dating stories that you would see girls and like then never want to see them again. Like, would they try to talk to you? Would they try to get you to date them again? Or what was that like?
So one thing proper dating etiquette is if you enjoy the first date, you're supposed to make plans for the second date.
And yeah.
Date, right? So you don't wait because I don't know, just things tend not to work out. Like if you like the first date, go ahead and make those plans.
Right.
And I rarely did that. I think I only did that a couple times. And then like on the second date, I think I went through with one of them. And then I was just like, yeah, I don't know. I don't really feel anything here. And the other time, I think I was genuinely got sick and I had to cancel. So, I really was sick.
Like knowing that you felt relieved after you couldn't show up for it probably would have told you something, right?
Yeah.
Dang.
Yeah. Well, you know, the excuse is always, well, she wasn't the right one or whatever.
So, yeah. We hear that a lot, don't we?
I get that. I mean, it really is. I think people should be picky about their romantic partners, and they need to try a lot of things. But nobody was really catching on there. So,
Do people in your life worry that you're lonely?
Occasionally, yeah. So probably my aunts, two aunts more than anybody else.
Yeah.
Will wonder, you know, what do you do with all your free time? Like, whatever I want to do.
Exactly. Yeah. As if I don't have enough stuff to do.
Right.
It's an issue I think a lot of people in our situation have, is that other people are processing us like you must have failed really hard and you're trying not to let anybody know how sad you are about it, but this is like genuinely what I want my life to be
like. I like being alone, yeah, so you know, but I can always well, not this year, but you know, I spend a lot of time with friends pre-COVID. I plan to again after this is over, things go well. So I really, you know, sometimes I actually do start to feel a little bit lonely, but I think it's normal to feel that every once in a while.
Sure. And
I still, you know, it's not a chronic issue. It's not like I spend every night wishing I had someone around, but because that's not true at all.
Right.
I like having the freedom of being able to decide what I get to do with my time. So,
people really underestimate how much they kind of, even if they have one other person living in their house or that they've created a duo with, that theoretically, like, they're not processing it like, oh, this is a drag on my freedom or anything. I know that's not how they think about it, but you always have to consider what the other person wants or how they feel. And even though you're glad to do that if you want them in your life, it's something that single people don't really have to think about.
Right.
And there is some positive to that.
One last thing. Yeah.
So you know, pre-COVID, you were pretty socially active.
I mean, I would, you know, like 2 or 3 times a week, I'll hang out with friends. So.
Oh. What do you like to do?
Good. Well, board games have been the thing the last few years. Yeah. Uh-huh. I think it started with Settlers of Catan.
Oh.
Oh man.
I was at a party where they played that once. I didn't play. I like to watch other people play board games. Like, if I don't really like to participate.
Yeah.
I just want to, like, bring the food and watch them eat my food and hang out.
Right. Yeah, board games, watch movies or TV or whatever. So.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Yeah. I think it's a good...
Just hang out.
Just chill. Yeah.
That sounds like a good time.
Yeah.
Yay. So let's see, what else can I talk about? I really want to talk to you about, like, we're about the same age. We're both 42.
Yeah.
And I've actually only had one person on this channel who identified as male, who was much, much younger than me. And that was a great interview too. But he came of age in the age of the internet and we did not.
Right.
So I'm really interested in both kind of how you are, you know, I guess one of the main things is that on Avon especially, and in all of our forums and in our polls and stuff, even non-binary people outnumber men in the ace community. And that's unusual in demographics of any place. So, you know, have any thoughts on kind of what it's like to be a male ace and kind of what's unique about it, I guess?
Right. Yeah. I don't know. I think to answer that question accurately, I would have to be a trans man or a trans woman, one of the two. Like, I haven't experienced life as a woman, so take this with a grain of salt.
Right.
I think there's a lot of social pressure for that men are supposed to be very sexual, and the more sex a man has, the more successful he is, right?
I've heard.
Yeah, and so... fortunately, a lot of my male friends were also very religious and not hypersexual, right? So it wasn't really like we weren't keeping score or anything.
Yeah.
So I think I didn't really feel that pressure as much, but I think a lot of men probably do. Yeah. Mm. So... I don't know. That's a tough question. It's one that I've been curious about for a long time, like why there's so few male asexuals on Avon. And could it just be that
started by one?
Yeah, that's right. David J. But is it because they just don't go to the forums, or are they out there but they're just isolated, they don't talk to other asexuals or do the Avon census, or I'm not really sure why that is. I don't know how the pressure to the societal pressure to have sex is for women. I don't know if there's a lot of pressure there to do that or not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's definitely a big difference between how we're treated depending on gender.
Yeah. It almost like women are supposed to be, is prude the right word?
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, if you want to generalize a whole lot, I definitely would say that men seem to be kind of pushed toward, you're supposed to pursue sex and we're supposed to, like, sort of resist it.
Yeah.
And if we, if we're too enthusiastic about accepting it, then we're slutty. Like, you don't want to be that, but you also don't want to be a prude.
Right.
It's kind of a trap.
Tie a rope.
Yeah.
Just which way do you go?
Yeah. Well, there is no right way, but.
Yeah. Whereas for, I think for men, it's just like, do what, you know, have as much as you can.
Right. As much as you can.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I guess. Sure.
But I think one thing that's probably very different about the Lady Ace experience is that I'm sometimes told that I'm supposed to just, there's nothing unique about being asexual because we're not supposed to enjoy it anyway, like that it's really for men, which doesn't explain lesbians, but
right. Yeah, like, that's true.
It's absolutely not true. And I mean, the sexual revolution of the 60s kind of showed that there were a lot of women who wanted to participate in sexual arenas without being told that it wasn't their place, or that this was, it's almost like sex was something that was done to us by men and that we're not supposed to, it doesn't matter if we enjoy it is ultimately the issue. Okay. So nobody cares. Right. And I think that that might be part of the reason why a lot of us are not worried about talking about it if we are asexual, because there are other women out there who say the same thing, whereas a lot of guys tend to like sort of shame each other or teach each other that they're not even fully human if they're not always chasing sex, you know?
Right. Yeah.
Human nature. And
I think that's true. Yeah.
I wonder how much of that you didn't really have to be in the thick of if you mostly had religious people around you, but
So I think that might be a part of what's called toxic toxic masculinity.
Oh yes.
Yeah. So yeah. I don't know.
you don't really feel like toxic masculinity really affected you emotionally at all, huh?
No, not really. I mean,
it's awesome.
I wasn't around it much, so like, I don't know. I guess a lot of my friends just weren't like these manly men, you know. I don't know.
Yeah. So
I had a lot of nerdy friends that.
Right.
Just, you know. Sexual either. You know, so.
Yeah. Yeah. That, I mean, that makes sense. If it's not really in the culture of the people that you were around, that you didn't develop like any kind of hang-ups about it.
What do you
think it was, like how did you react if you saw maybe depictions like that of kind of toxic masculinity in media? Did you ever like wonder what the heck that's about?
I don't know. I guess I knew about it, but I never really had to deal with it personally.
Right.
Oh, so, I don't know. I'm trying to think of like, a lot of movies portray men as being these, you know, macho, you know, sex beasts. So, I kind of like, I knew about it, but it was like, I never really had to deal with it personally. So I was really fortunate. So I see, I don't know if the movies are exaggerating that or.
Right.
Is it really that prevalent? I don't know.
Yeah, it seems like a reasonable conclusion to say, but that's just the movies. If it's not your experience, it's just so easy to go, nobody's like that.
Surely not.
Yeah, well, I think even the real life examples of it are not like the movies anyway, but that's where some people get their ideas of what's girly and what's masculine and all that
stuff. Yeah, that's absolutely true. Yeah.
You know, I don't know. And it's, I don't know if you have experienced this the way that I kind of have, but in media, when somebody's motivated by sex, I don't get it. Like, I don't understand what the appeal is, like what is driving this book forward or what is driving this movie, because I'm just like, okay, if you say so, but I don't find it interesting.
Yeah, I completely agree. There's a show on it was on Amazon Prime, I think it's called Upload. Anyway, it's about
I'm not
when you die, your consciousness gets uploaded into a computer or whatever. But they've also threw in this love story. You're like, a big chunk of the show is this love story. I'm like, I don't care about that stuff. It's just like that
interesting part.
just take that out, you know? It's a pretty good show. You should watch it. But there is a love story. And yeah, it definitely motivates the characters. I'm like, yeah. It's like, but you can also just say, well, they're just close friends too. And right. Maybe, you know, that could drive them to do the same things in this show. So
A friend of mine has mentioned this show to me and has told me a couple of things about it being good, but I have not yet checked it out. Of course, I don't have these, what do you call them? Like those streaming services. I don't have any. So
Amazon Prime.
Amazon Prime. Do I have that? You know, I don't remember right now if I have a membership.
But, anyway,
I might, but either way, I have a friend who has a lot of the services, so I could probably see whatever I want.
Yeah, that's right.
But yeah, it is a little alienating sometimes when like the whole thing that makes a piece of fiction satisfying is like somebody getting the girl, and I'm like, all right, what else is there?
Yeah, right.
You know, it is what it is.
That's right.
Yeah. So I guess I'll take a left at the questions here and ask you a couple of little interjections.
Sure.
Your opinion on what do you think the hardest things about being ace have been for you?
Hardest things about being asexual. I think it would be really nice to meet more asexuals in person. I think it's kind of hard to find any in Kentucky, whole state. I go to a wonderful meetup in Cincinnati, which is close.
Oh, okay.
We get like 4 to 8 people a meeting, but not this year because COVID wrecked everything. But and the last time they met, I just got back from Italy and didn't get to go. So, I've tried a few times to get some meetups together in Kentucky, and usually just flakes out or I can't get any interest.
You tried to like run a meetup?
Yeah, on the Avon Meetup Mart, I had posted some things.
Okay.
And, nothing really gelled.
Okay.
It has been a while since I've tried, but
yeah.
Yeah.
A while since a lot of us have tried to do anything.
I know. But I think that's kind of the hardest thing is to find people, similar minded people to talk to and hang out, you know, just hang out with.
Mm-hmm.
But those meetups have been really wonderful.
Mm-hmm. What did y'all do?
I guess the other weird thing is, the other hard thing I think is when people are talking about sex or, you know, or a lot of guys will say, she's hot or whatever, do her, you know, and you're like, and I'm just kind of saying,
know what I mean, say no more.
And you know, those conversations can be really awkward. Usually it's a group situation or whatever. So, you know, I'm not having to respond directly, but it's
right.
It can be a little alienating, you know, it's like, you just want, I don't know. You just kind of want to steer the subject away.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, really that's kind of a weak answer because there's not a lot of difficult things for me anyway, personally, for,
Oh, it's good to hear.
Yeah. No.
Yeah, because I know that some people have had like a really tough time. I mean, especially if they don't have supportive family or if they are in a relationship that's this is causing strife, then it, you know, it's magnified. But, you know, I think you and me have had kind of a very similar experience because I guess also being aromantic and being fairly independent,
Right. I think it would be tough if I had a strong desire for a romantic relationship. I think that would be really tough.
Yeah.
But it's kind of like putting the two positives of a magnet together.
Yeah.
Well, I want this, but nobody else does. Mm-hmm. I think most people wouldn't be open to a romantic relationship without sex.
Mm-hmm.
Unless they were also asexual, and then your dating pool shrinks down to almost nothing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if you've ever had to deal with detractors who say, like, you know, science things, or like, it's biologically impossible to be asexual. Everyone has this urge. Like, do you ever have to deal with people like that?
Not really, no. I guess because people don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't have it tattooed to my forehead. So
they're not on YouTube or writing articles, having people evaluate
your stuff. Yeah, I'm sure you deal with it all the time, but the thing is, I could argue my way out of it pretty well. It's like, we have 7 billion people. We don't all need to reproduce.
That's right.
For the race to continue. Mm-hmm. But if you study like groups of animals, I think it was the meerkats, maybe? Like, I think meerkats, they would, if a predator attacked, one of them would actually run out and distract it, so the others could get to safety. And, this was Anthony Bogart studied this, actually, in one of his books.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like, well, that seems weird. It's like it's not, or it's giving up its own life to try to save the others. But if you think of it as one organism together and just one part of it's defending the rest, it kind of makes sense in a way. So asexuality, I guess, could be similar. Is, you know, somebody who's asexual can still provide a lot of benefit to others without making more people.
Sure.
Like, it's not the only,
Yeah. Plus, most of us are coming out of straight people, so I mean, it's not necessarily that it's a genetic thing.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Yeah.
You know. So. I don't know. I definitely feel like people are really hung up on that biology thing. Like, how can you not want to do this? It's scientifically blah, blah, blah. And, you know, I hate having to try to address people like that, because, I mean, especially since most of the people who are not having children are people who are still having sex.
Right.
Exactly. Birth control and all that stuff.
Yeah, birth control unnatural.
Yeah.
I guess it is, but it's man-made.
It just seems very silly to
point
at us and say we're the unnatural ones. But yeah, in the animal kingdom, there's gay animals. There's animals who abstain.
Yeah, so, absolutely.
I don't know.
I mean, you could just draw a bell curve.
Yeah.
And if you know, average people are, you know, make a majority of the, you know, their sexual desire is somewhere in the middle, and they make up the majority. And if you keep going higher and higher, you get into like deviance and, you know, people who just can't control themselves, right? Or on one end of the bell curve. And it makes sense on the other end, with just people who just don't care, right?
Right.
It's just statistically going to happen. So,
Yeah. It's just, I mean, it just isn't hard to imagine that, like, from a data standpoint at all. And it wouldn't really make sense if every single one of us was sexually successful to the point of reproduction. Like, it just wouldn't make sense.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, well, let's turn it around and say, what do you think the best things for you have been about being asexual?
The best things? So I hear that sex is a huge hassle, is what I've heard. And I don't have to deal with that. So
a hassle, you know, people
spend so much energy searching for a sexual partner in the act itself. Mm-hmm. They end up with unwanted diseases, you know, STDs or whatever, mm-hmm. or unwanted pregnancies.
Right.
People spend a lot of time worried about sex, and I don't have that problem. So I can use that energy to do whatever else I really feel like doing, which is kind of cool. So I think that's one really nice thing about it.
I would agree.
Yeah. That's good. And you know, you just get yourself into a lot of, if people are responsible about sex, you know, they can do it safe and they're not going to get in any trouble. But a lot of people do, you know, they have a lot of kids and they can't really afford them. They didn't really plan on it or want it. And, you know, they get in really bad situations.
Yeah.
I don't have to deal with any of that. Yeah.
Yeah, I can relate to that. You know, I'm a really busy and creative person, and sometimes every once in a while people say, this is because you don't have to keep a man happy. And I'm like, well, I'd like to think I would still be doing a lot of this stuff if I did have a partner, but at the same time, it's true.
Right. It's absolutely true.
Like, you know, I don't have any 6-year-old over there saying that he doesn't want to eat my casserole and I have to make him a peanut butter and jelly tonight, and
right.
You know, I don't have to deal with that. I'm sure obviously all of that has its own rewards, but it's always nice, you know. There's no parent and there's no person who has a partner on the planet who hasn't been like, you know, I just wish I didn't have to deal with this right now. And
right. Yeah.
To deal with it.
Grass is always greener on the other side, right?
So. Yeah. I mean, especially since like both of us, like we want it to be this way. It would be like the downside to be kind of end up in a situation and be like, this is not how I saw my life.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know. But people have a really hard time wrapping their head around that being a desire. Like they can kind of imagine settling for it and deciding, okay, I can be happy like this, but it's sort of like, I really wanted it to be like this. This is how I want it. This is my dream. So.
Yeah, absolutely. It's nothing to fix.
Yeah. Not that long ago, I got like a really in-depth comment from somebody who was just so inappropriately invested in telling me that my life was regressive, she said. I'm like, why do you define it that way though? Like,
yeah. Regressive, what meaning, like childish or?
Yeah, I guess so. Well, I guess she was processing me as like, I guess stuck on relationships that happened a long time ago and that I never got over it or something. And that this is like everything as a 40-plus-year-old woman, that everything that I'm doing is a manifestation of never getting over hurtful things that happened in high school or something. And I'm like, okay, number one, like you're watching a microcosm of my life on these YouTube videos where I'm talking about that. So that's ridiculous. But I mean, I think the other big thing is just, I'm really into cartoons and I have a lot of toys and stuff. And I'm sure that probably spinning that around to be about your life, it might be like, oh, you get together with your friends and you play games.
Yeah.
Like, what kind of baby are you? You know,
right, exactly.
Like these are fun. Like, why does your life have to be boring and not colorful if you're an adult?
Right.
Like, does it just have to suck or you're not really a grown up? Right.
I think people just, they think society expects these things of them and they get locked into this thought that, well, this is what I need to be like to be a successful adult. And they're too scared I think they're too scared to break the mold. And think about doing the things that they actually want to do. Mm-hmm. You know, if they want to watch cartoons, fine.
You want to walk around with a dragon on your shirt and be all like, look at my dragon.
Right. Dragon.
Yeah. I don't know. It's just like, I'm thinking about that movie, The 40-Year-Old Virgin. Like, so much of it was like,
I was- surprised how good it was.
Yeah, it had some good stuff in it, but it still left like kind of a bad taste in my mouth sometimes because of the way that they talked about his toys and how he still kind of sort of moved on from some of it.
Right.
To show that he was a grown up and he was in this relationship now, so blah blah. And I'm like, you know, but I agree with you. There was some good stuff in there too, because he at least spoke in defense of some of these things.
Yeah. Well, I thought they were going to make him out to be this buffoon the whole time, but he really wasn't. You know,
he's
a good guy. I can't remember, did they make him get rid of all his toys, or did he hang on to them? Did he manage to keep them around? I can't remember how that worked out.
I think he gave away, like, or he got rid of some of them, or maybe most of them. Now we're talking about the plot of a movie, but
I know. Sorry.
No, I feel like I don't remember it clearly enough, but I do own it on DVD. Because I just, you know, I had to. There was a period in my life when I was the 40-year-old virgin, but you know, it wasn't him. So I do have so many toys, but I don't like the idea that you have to, the idea that that makes you childish, or that you have to grow up and be legitimate, you have to move past certain things that give you joy. And that bothers me. You know?
Yeah, this makes sense. I think as long as you are, assuming you're able to work, you know, that you work, you pay your bills, you're responsible, mm-hmm. you're in that way, you're contributing to society at least. Mm-hmm. And then whatever you do for fun, whatever, you know, it's like,
Right. Yeah. And if you aren't able to contribute in a traditional way, like, it's just like, there are plenty of people who are not asexual who are in that situation as well. And you know, we all have a right to be here and everything. But yeah, like, adulthood isn't defined by looking enough like the prepackaged adult on paper. And like, still, I've got a 401k, I've got insurance, like,
exactly.
I've just also got toys.
Savings account, so, you know, doing the adult thing.
Yeah. I don't know. But sometimes I'll eat a cookie for breakfast, but most of the time I have coffee and toast, you know? It's unfortunate how the perception of an adult is so narrow sometimes, and that sex and relationships are kind of mixed in there to exclude people like us, and that's completely not necessary.
Right. It's
inaccurate, and they're missing out on understanding something very important about humans by categorizing us that way, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Mm-hmm.
Fortunately, I don't really get a lot of flack for that, so my friends are very understanding, and
it's good. You know,
But I could see how someone might have that perception that I'm not a successful adult if I don't have a relationship or kids, you know.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any pets?
You know, I don't want a dog, no thanks, because I don't want to have to take it out to poop every day. And I'm semi-allergic to cats. It's enough that I love cats. Cats are great, but I wouldn't want to live with one. So I occasionally take care of my parents' cat for a few weeks at a time. But and that's, I like that. That's fun. But then I get to get rid of them. So
right.
Yeah. So no pets. How about you?
No, me either. And same situation too, because I'm allergic to some cats. And I still haven't figured out the pattern. But I think if I like had to have a pet, I would like to have, I would have a cat, just because they're pretty independent.
Exactly.
And they poop in a box.
Exactly.
I do kind of like them in theory, but I don't like the cat hair thing.
Right.
The deal is with the, sometimes I've had a really bad reaction to cats and then other times nothing. So
yeah,
I haven't figured it out. But, you know, how am I going to be a cat lady?
The old cat lady. the meme, yeah.
Can't even have one, so.
Yeah, I don't know.
So, I want to talk about the older ace thing.
Sure.
Because, again, we came of age before the internet.
That's right, which yeah.
Seems weird now because it's such a big part of my life, but.
I know. It is weird.
I mean, it's like analog childhood.
Did you use modems when they came out?
Did I what?
Did you use modems? Like the 56, the one where you dial up with the phone and made those weird noises?
Yeah. I mean, I had an external modem on my first machines.
I just can't believe, like, it was so slow to get any information that way.
Yeah.
You just pull out your phone, you can look up anything, anywhere you are.
Like, yeah, it's really so different now. I mean, you're not going to have like a 30-minute argument in the restaurant about whether some actor was in this movie because somebody will pull out their phone and answer that in 2 seconds.
Oh, there it is. Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know.
It's weird because it didn't seem strange. Because as the stuff gradually changed, you know, it was like, okay, cool, yeah, oh, cellular technology, what? But now if you just look, if you think back to the 80s, you're like, what?
Right.
No internet.
Yeah, I had to explain that to a friend of mine's daughter when she got old enough that her mom let her make her own Facebook account. Okay. I was talking to her on like her first day of middle school and I'm like, oh, so I saw your mom let you have a Facebook account. That's pretty cool. Well, they didn't have Facebook when I was a kid. And she goes, oh, it wasn't invented yet. And I'm like, they didn't have the internet. There was no internet. And there was just silence, like her trying to imagine that. But I'm kind of glad that there was no internet because I probably would have been one of the earliest like memes of some kid doing something embarrassing on the internet and getting made fun of for it, because I was always making really cringy stuff and like I would have been very proud of it. And like you could argue that I'm still doing that, so
yeah, okay,
you know, not a child, but right. Anyway, I could imagine that the kinds of crap that I've put up with on the internet as an adult would have been a lot more painful as a child. So I'm kind of glad that I was sheltered from that and could only get made fun of by kids in my class. So.
Yeah. Cyberbullying. I mean, that wasn't a thing for us.
Right.
But the real problem, like kids are going to therapy over cyberbullying. So it's a horrible thing. So
yeah, it's really bad. But yeah, you know,
go ahead.
It's cool that there's resources for people who are trying to figure out what's going on with them, like you did the same
thing
where you were able to look on the internet because of when you started wondering these things,
right?
Exactly. Something to find, whereas you know,
without the internet, I don't think I would have ever figured it out, because maybe I would have gone to therapy eventually and been like, I haven't been to therapy since I was like a teenager, but there's nothing wrong with it. I just, maybe if I had wondered enough, maybe I would have seen a therapist and maybe they would have, you know, told me what this is, but maybe nope. Like maybe it wouldn't even be in the DSM without the internet. Because
right,
it's a community they kind of built up on the internet. I don't know. And actually, if I think back, there was, when I was in, I think it was a freshman in high school, there was another girl in my class who said she was, I think she called herself like anasexual or something. Like she just said she wasn't interested in sex.
Okay.
But you know, that's the only person ever that I've come into contact with who's told me anything like that. So I think, without the internet, I never would have figured it out.
Yeah. It's definitely shaped a lot of my understandings of kind of what's going on with me, because I think I was very similar to you in that I was kind of like, I don't want to date and I don't want to have sex. And now most of the ace community says, I don't experience sexual attraction. And I'm like, well, that's also true, but I wouldn't have thought of it like that without other people talking about it. And I'm like, well, I guess that is kind of how you define most sexual orientations.
Right. Yeah.
The attraction that you experience. And that's, you know, that's true. I mean, nothing happens when somebody that I like is around and I like them very much, but I have no attraction of that nature. And
yeah, right.
I think I mostly still would have been defining it as, I don't want to do these two things. I don't want to date them or have sex with them.
Right. That makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's probably where I would still be. And I would always be wondering if, I guess I would always be wondering if it was normal because, you know, just not knowing anybody like this, you know, any other in person, who would you talk to about it?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think a lot of us who knew that we were asexual or not interested or whatever when we were kids and there was no internet, I think a lot of us kind of invented a term for it. Did you have anything that you called it, or did you kind of not conceive of yourself that way?
Well, so the, when I looked for it on the internet, I found Avon right away. So that, you know, the asexual, visibility education network. So I was like, oh, asexual. Oh, right. Okay. Uh-huh. So I guess I didn't have a term other than kind of how you're describing it is I just don't want these things. So So I didn't really, But it made sense. Like, the root A means not. So, okay.
Yep.
Sure.
Yeah. I called myself non-sexual for years.
Not non-sexual. Well, that makes sense too. Or unsexual.
Right.
Sounds a little weird.
There were some people saying they were anti-sexual for a while too.
Anti-sexual.
That almost sounds like they don't want it for other people.
Either. Yeah. Nobody. I'm like, no. We're wait a minute.
It. We will stamp it out.
Yeah.
I
can't advocate for that.
I think it sounds like though that you were not particularly troubled by it when you were younger. You were just like kind of like, oh, it's a curiosity.
Yeah, I think so. I touched a little bit on this in our email, but I grew up as a Catholic.
Oh yeah, let's talk about that stuff too.
Roman Catholic. So I went to a private grade school. And then I think it was in middle school when I actually went over to a public school. So my early childhood, you know, very Catholic, very, very closed in. Sex is taboo, right? Whatever. But I went to public school I think it was sixth grade on up through high school. So, you know, public school was definitely more, you would hear more about people, you know, getting together. And, a lot of my friends were nerds, just like me. And we liked playing video games, right? And we just didn't really talk about girls or women in that way. And, it's kind of weird because in my friend circle, nobody was dating. And so, yeah, so I don't know. And then like my very closest friend, he's Muslim. Mm-hmm. So he didn't start dating until he was an adult.
Okay.
You know, well after high school. So, and then that was... Again, that so you know, Muslims are against premarital sex, just like Catholics. Anyway, Catholics. So I guess I just wasn't exposed to a lot of people that were highly sexual.
Right.
So I think that made it easier for me to fit in, and I guess I just didn't think it was that odd because most of my friends weren't doing it either. So, yeah. But then, you know, I'd hear about people having sex, but it seemed rare, I guess, in high school. So,
I see. Well, if you were raised in a religious environment, I guess you probably couldn't have missed when they would warn you about temptation.
Absolutely.
So did that confuse you?
Yeah, you know, so Christianity in general is, there's definitely a purity culture of, you don't do it before marriage, and like no sex before marriage, no masturbation, and they're also against birth control.
Some of them are. It's true.
Yeah, I think at least Catholicism is, right? No birth control.
Yeah.
You know, so there's this, God really cares about what people do in the bed, I guess. So I grew up and you know, so premarital sex was a sin, right? If you do this, you're going to hell. And even, I think, yeah, even just like lusting after, you know, someone was considered a sin. And, so definitely, celibacy was demanded by the religion. Now, so I never understood what the big deal was. It was like,
yeah,
okay, you can't have sex before marriage. And I'm like, okay. I mean, it never felt like a struggle to me. But then I started learning that a lot of people struggled with that requirement. Like, that's actually supposed to be really difficult to stay celibate. And I'm like, that never bothered me.
Mm-hmm.
So I think in my personal experience, that really muddied the waters for me. It made it harder for me to understand that there was something different about me. It's like, well, I'm just being a good Catholic and not really wanting sex and not doing it. So, yeah, I'm just Catholic. But in my early 30s, mid 30s, I started to kind of shed those religious beliefs. And I kind of peeled that away. And then I was like, well, I started to think, well, I mean, premarital sex, why is that a sin? That's not, no one's getting hurt here. As long as it's consensual, right? It's consensual and you're being careful about unwanted pregnancies and disease. What's the sin here? Who's getting hurt?
Right.
And I started to think about these things logically, and then it started to click with me, like, but I still don't, you know, I think maybe before I was reluctant because of the sinful nature of sex.
Uh-huh.
But as I peeled that away, I was like, well, no, I'm not. I still don't want it. So,
right.
Huh, that's strange.
Mm-hmm.
But that's kind of my personal experience. I don't think being Catholic made me asexual, but I think it made it harder for me to understand that I was.
I see. Hmm. Yeah. You had to do confessions in your
Yeah, Catholicism is about, yeah, you do confessions.
Right.
But I think like I find women aesthetically pleasing.
Mm-hmm.
I had the aesthetic attraction or whatever. So I think I confessed that, like, you know, I was staring at some woman or whatever. She was beautiful. I confessed that. Like, not a sin.
Yeah.
But
yeah, I was curious if anybody ever thought it was weird that you would claim that you were not having these thoughts at all. If you discussed it, I don't know if you even would, but did they doubt that you were even telling the truth?
Sorry, I froze there for a second. Could you ask that again?
Yeah, mine kind of glitched too. I was wondering, like, did you ever have the experience of somebody not believing that you were if you said you didn't have these thoughts or that you weren't committing any of these sins or whatever, that you weren't tempted, did people believe right. you, or did they tell you that you must be having them? Or if you didn't talk about this,
I don't know. I don't think I told anybody that. So,
Okay.
I guess it never came up.
So yeah. You never had that experience.
Not even my mom.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Not even my mom really asked me about that stuff. So. No.
It's interesting because I definitely had some experiences like that where people were like, you know that you're thinking it, you know you want to do it, I know what you teenagers are up to, and I'm like, you do? Because I'm not. But even today, like, I mean, my mom believes me now that I wasn't running off to screw anyone in the car, but
right.
It's funny because now she's kind of gotten a taste of that, where people will say, if she talks about my work or whatever, it's like, I have a daughter who, she published this book about asexuality, you know, and there'll be some conversation about it. And I don't know, my mom thinks it's a novelty to tell people that, you know, one of her daughters has never had sex, and they're like, sure, mom, she's just not telling you, honey. So like, now right, she's getting the disbelief. I'm like, well,
yeah. Well, I mean, how do you prove that you didn't think about something? Or how, I mean,
right,
like, okay, prove me wrong, good luck.
Yeah. It's not really that important to me to, like, I don't need them to believe me necessarily, but it is really suspicious sometimes that they're like, okay, this is a very common experience, so I can't believe it doesn't happen to you, even though you report otherwise. Sorry to rock your world over here.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, that's part of the whole point of being, like, we're, what, like, 1% of the population, it's estimated. It is pretty rare. We are saying it's not common, but it is possible.
Right.
Like you were saying with bell curves and everything.
Yeah, exactly. That's four standard deviations, something like that. So it's not that weird.
Yeah, it's really just not. It's not impossible. It's not.
I kind of wish we had a more accurate number than 1%. Like, we don't really know.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you think about guessing. That? Like, do you think it's more or less, or data inconclusive?
Data inconclusive. I think it's less, but
yeah.
I think it's more like 0.5%.
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you think?
Hard to tell because it could go either way, because I have had very few encounters in the wild with people who are asexual, and what is it, like 1 or 2% of people have red hair, and I've definitely met more redheads than that, so
yeah.
I don't know. But exactly. On the other hand, it's like, if you count the whole asexual spectrum, like, you know, people who identify as demisexual or gray sexual, I think it would definitely be more if you have all of that in there. Plus, there might be underreporting, especially like kind of we were talking about before with men, that some of them are like, well, you know, I'm not really experiencing this attraction, but I like sex, or I don't mind sex, and it's culturally important to me to have sex. So they're not identifying that way.
Right.
You know, and then some people who have had sex think that they can't be asexual, or they didn't desire it, but they could deal with it, or even kind of liked it. They would be like, I can't be asexual. So it might be underreported at one. It's really hard to tell because nobody knows really what it is at the end of the day. It counts.
Yeah. It's hard to, hard to quantify a negative.
Yeah.
It's hard to say there's not something, especially when it's an emotion or feeling, or I don't even know what you call it, but
it's true.
Something in the brain. You can't really measure it, and it's just a subjective, like, whether you feel that or not.
Yes.
And if you've never felt something, how do you know you haven't? Like, If you were color, if you were born colorblind and then someone said, well, have you seen the color red? Then you would say, well, maybe. Like, right. If you've seen red things, it looks different kind of gray to you. And I don't know. It's I'm getting
That's a good analogy.
Yeah. Maybe.
I think that's a good analogy because, you know, then they're asking us, like, what do we mean by sexual attraction? It's like, you're asking us? I don't know. Mostly they're just saying, you know it when it happens to you. And we're like, I guess it never happened then. I don't know. I don't know. But it is all very subjective. That's the perfect word for it because you do get, like, again, I've talked to kind of too many science jackasses who are saying, like, you can't prove this, or if we could make you have a sexual response in a lab, then that would prove that you weren't, or something. I'm like, no, it really wouldn't. You don't go to the doctor to get diagnosed as straight. So, yeah. I mean, how does this work? It is, by definition, a description of a feeling, and you can do science about that, but you can't, I mean, I can't prove that I believe in God or that I don't believe in God. So, exactly, I mean, you can still collect data about atheists versus theists.
Right. Exactly.
So, you know, it's like that, I think.
Yeah.
You know, you do the best you can. And a lot of us are colorblind about sex. color blindness runs in my family, actually.
Oh, really? Well, what kind?
Huh?
What kind? There's several.
As far as I know, my dad is red-green colorblind, and I'm not sure about my nephew. He has some kind of color blindness, but we're not really sure what yet.
Gotcha.
Because he's young. So. Yeah. But I am one of three girls, and none of us inherited the color blindness, but I mean, obviously we're probably carriers, so.
Right. It's more common in men, I think, because.
Yeah.
I don't know.
One of those recessive genes, I guess.
Yeah, it's really weird.
Yeah. Not sure exactly how that works, but yeah, it's not, not common with ladies.
Right.
It's what it is.
Yep.
But, you know, I can see colors, but can't feel sexual attraction. And I can't buy, like, those cool glasses to make me see it. Like, oh, that person's sexy now.
We should get those so that we can fit in better.
See, I just, I don't know. But, you know, I agree with.
8 out of 10.
There's, like, a readout on the side.
Here's what you should
how sexy
say.
That person is. Wow. Oh my gosh. See, now we need a patent.
Yep. Yes. AR glasses that tell you how sexy people are. So you fit in. We got it.
Wow.
Get right on it.
We'll corner of the asexual market.
Yes.
That, like, in reality though, that would be super creepy.
it's not good.
No. But, like, in seriousness though, like, when you said that about, like, how women are aesthetically appealing or whatever, that they might be beautiful or whatever, I think that too. I think, like, I've wondered occasionally, like, am I technically a little more attracted to ladies than I am to men? Because I think ladies are prettier, but I think ladies are just prettier.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
I don't know. Maybe that's just me, and maybe it's just an objective fact.
Yeah. I don't know.
It might just be how media does things.
Could be.
I really don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's a big difference between it being attracted to someone and thinking that they are appealing visually. So, right. I don't know. Do you do any art or anything?
I actually write music. Right. I do electronic music.
Oh, that's awesome. See, I went to school for music. I majored in music for a year and a half.
Nice.
Wait, instruments?
You play any instruments?
Yes, but my instrument was voice.
Oh, okay.
But it was like a music ed degree, so they make you kind of take a bunch of crash courses on how to play instruments. So I learned, you know, flute and clarinet and trumpet and trombone and drums. I just didn't get far enough to get into the strings class because I dropped it and I moved into from music education to just education. But played violin in middle school, and I just, in the last few years, taught myself ukulele.
Okay.
So that'll do. But it's mostly just singing.
I don't actually play any instruments, so I just write the music. I understand music theory pretty well.
Yay, that's cool. Well, you need to write it.
That stepped up my game a lot. Like, I was terrible for the, like, I wrote a few songs. I had no clue about scales or anything. I was like, that was awful. Once I learned that, I was like, oh.
Yeah.
Those are the notes I was supposed to use.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you can kind of almost like mathematically figure it out.
Yeah. But once you know those, you know when you can break them, too. That's
yeah. Oh, that was a big deal in music school. Like, they'd teach you the rules, and then they'd be like, which one of these part writing exercises is breaking the rules? And, fix it. I'm like, what if I don't want to fix it? I like tritones. Shut up.
Good to me. Yeah. I like Phrygian mode. So
this is like the second time modes have come up in 2 days for me. But I have some music geek friends, so
yeah. Phrygian mode is the best.
See, I like Lydian.
Lydian's good too. It's got a sweet sound. Lydian mode.
But whatever, you know.
It's music dorks.
I just really like that. You know, it's actually kind of a little bit like living as an asexual person, where like we grow up with this specific scale, and then you find out there's like, it's not the scale, it's a scale. Right. And there are all these other ways you can be.
Yeah.
All these other things you could do that are also legit. We invented all this crap.
Yeah.
I mean, there's like science to understanding why a perfect fourth and a perfect fifth is perfect. But at the same time, like, the scale is a construction of how we do Western music. So
that's right. Yeah.
So now that we have thoroughly confused a lot of people.
Yeah. Oh, what are they talking about?
I promise it's sort of relevant to everyone who's not a music person or like plays by ear. And that's legit too, because you can write songs like that. It's like, you just won't be writing them down on my manuscript paper or having an electronic score.
Right.
Makes sense, I promise.
It really does.
Yeah, I'm not good at math, so I was kind of, I don't know, I was not, I was pretty good at music theory, but I think if I had tried to go a lot farther, my math skills would have made me fall through the floor.
Yeah, you get into weird things with, we're getting way off topic, just intonation. Do you know what that is?
Do what?
Just intonation.
Just?
Yeah, it's called just intonation. So you know, our scale is logarithmically divided so that every note is the same multiple of the one before it.
Uh-huh.
So that when you do that 12 times, you get like times two or whatever, right?
Uh-huh.
To the octave. So just intonation, though, each note has different intervals between them, and you use like, this note is 4/3 the frequency of the one before it, and then the next one is 7/8 or 8/7 of that or whatever.
Uh-huh.
So you use rational numbers to multiply and get your octaves that way, and it comes out with a weird, just a different sound to it. It's really cool. Look it up.
Neat.
Yeah.
I'm not familiar with it. I mean, I understood what you said, but
I
don't think I've ever
heard that. You could actually tune your violin to use just intonation.
Oh, Lord.
It's a little different. Yeah.
Oh, I bet that's weird.
Yeah.
Well, it just depends on kind of the worldview that you're working within.
Yeah.
And you can still make something beautiful.
Yeah.
So is there anything else that we have not covered to your satisfaction, or anything else you want to talk about before we kind of wrap up the interview portion of this and stop talking to camera?
So I don't know if it's relevant, but I had a near-death experience.
Oh, goodness. Okay.
If you want to hear about that. So in this is in 2007.
Okay.
I was riding my bike. I love riding bikes, by the way. Anyway, so I was riding my bike, and I was actually hit by a car. So
uh-huh.
I was waiting at an intersection.
Yikes.
Hit by a car, and the EMS came, got me, took me to the hospital. And I mean, it was pretty close. I almost died. So.
Damn.
Yeah, it wasn't a sure thing that I would be here today.
Wow.
So, anyway, so I spent a lot of time in the ICU and then rehab and all that. But I think it kind of like changed the way I view life. Like I'm more, I guess I'm more grateful for every day and the things that I have. Mm-hmm. And it also kind of opened me up to exploring or more like maybe more skepticism or questioning the things that I took for granted, you know, my whole life or whatever. So, I don't know if that's relevant to asexuality, other than to say that I don't think it had any effect on my sexuality in the long run. Like, I don't think I was sexual before that. And then it got knocked out of me.
Doesn't sound like it.
Yeah. So, yeah, but maybe it helped me lead me along the path of exploring it as a possibility later on. So.
Oh, that's really interesting. Like something sort of shook you up and made you say, I want to look into understanding these things in a different way.
Yeah, like I think maybe the first thing I started to look at was my religion, like the mm-hmm. beliefs I had growing up. And
wow.
Kind of looking at it with a more... Skepticism is just only accepting things based on evidence, right? So you start looking at religion and you know, say, well, what evidence do I have for this? And so on.
Uh-huh.
So yeah, and I think before that I was more closed in. I was more worried about doing the things that society expected me to do or like fitting the mold. Mm. And I think after that I was like, screw the mold. I'm gonna live my life the way I want to. And
yeah, you have it.
Yeah, exactly. Like you just got the one life. So
yeah.
Don't. Well, most people, some people believe they don't, but
right. Yeah.
There's only one life that you can be absolutely sure you have. It's this one. So mm-hmm. definitely enjoy it. And I don't let people tell you to be a certain way if you mm-hmm. aren't that way.
Mm-hmm.
As long as you're not hurting anybody.
Yeah.
Do what you want.
So. Well, that's a great philosophy. I mean, you have to wonder, like, if nothing had kind of rattled you around and made you think about that, like, would you have done more of, like, let me find out how I can be more like what I'm expected to be and maybe be in some kind of relationship that you weren't satisfied in and
right, yeah. You know,
what could have happened. But I guess you can coulda, shoulda, woulda all day. So
I know.
It'll but that's drive really you interesting.
Crazy. Yeah.
I've been hit by a car too, but I didn't even fall. I fell off once and like definitely not a near death experience.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, I've never been through something like that.
Yeah.
You hear about kind of dramatic stuff where people will like come back with a different accent or something, but you know,
really,
like I've heard of that.
Oh, that's strange.
Yeah, it's super weird. It's probably some kind of brain damage, but
yeah, right.
You know, this was not.
Which accent is caused by brain damage?
No, I have no idea, like, how they probably had some kind of different way of forming their words that was being processed as this different accent or something. I have no idea, but I heard this story once about that happening to someone after they were in some kind of traumatic thing. But
they didn't wake up and go like, crikey. Like,
they're suddenly Steve Irwin.
Yeah. Also, I noticed you have a Dance Dance Revolution head.
Yes. In the corner. I do. I'm very good at Dance Dance Revolution.
I played for, I actually had it on the PlayStation. I had a few different versions of it. It was really good exercise for a while.
Oh, yeah. It is definitely good exercise. That's a hard metal pad.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And that's because I'll skid off the pad if it's on a soft one because I'm too fast. And
cool.
You know, so I don't have the bar or anything, but I have to have a metal one because I like to play on the heavy mode.
Right.
I'm not going to win any tournaments or anything, but I'm pretty good. I have a really old DDR video on my channel somewhere if you dig.
Okay. Might look around.
But it's 14 years old. Oh, no. And I still play. So that's fun.
Yeah. Well, what console do you have?
Oh, I don't. I have an emulator.
Gotcha. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, you have to I don't have anything to play it on, but you have to own the game and then you can put all your songs into the emulator.
Cool.
Yeah. So awesome. Yeah, I have a good time. Just, by myself here, I'm my own biggest fan playing the game.
Good exercise.
You can play it in the middle of the night because there's nobody sleeping in the other room.
Exactly.
But you live by yourself too, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm. When did you move out of a living situation where you live with others?
So when I graduated high school, of course, I was still living with my parents then. And then I went to Purdue for college, but there I was living in a dorm, with a roommate or whatever.
Okay.
After I graduated there, I got my own house. I got an apartment here. So that was when I was 21, or I think it was 21, 22 maybe. When I got an apartment here. So I've been living alone ever since. That's 20 years.
Gosh.
Yeah.
We're really similar that way too then, because that's what I did too. Except I didn't live in the dorms, but I lived with roommates in college and then got my own apartment, and it's been the same since.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think it's great. You have your own place, space that you can decorate up or whatever, get some purple lights.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm so spoiled about that now.
These are Philips Hue bulbs. They can be any color. So,
what are they?
Philips Hue.
Philips Hue.
Yeah, I chose purple for this occasion.
Yay!
And now I look yellow. So
now you look yellow. Compliment.
And the price.
I just felt pink today, so I did all my makeup in pink.
Nice. Very good.
Pink today.
Yeah.
I think that I have so much crap. I don't know if you're kind of like a mini hoarder like me, but I have so much crap. So I have how big is this house? I can't remember how big the house is. I think it's almost 1,500 square feet. Does that sound right?
Sure.
That it's 4 bedrooms and I just live here by myself.
Yeah.
Because I have so much crap. But I wanted to have an office. I'm in my office. This is what my office looks like.
Yeah. I'm in my office. So,
I have a bedroom and I have a guest room, which I got a guest room in case just in case people stay over, but also just in case something happens with my mom is not all that healthy, and I was just thinking, if she needs some place to stay at some point, I'd have a place for her to stay with me so I could help her or something.
Cool.
Yeah, but but mostly it's because I have a lot of crap.
Yeah. So this place is I live in a condo. I think it's 1400 square feet. It's got two bedrooms in this office, and I'm kind of a minimalist. Like, there's kind of a lot of junk in the background here, but the rest of the place is pretty stark. So I have a whole lot of stuff here.
Yeah. Is that vinyl records?
It is.
Yeah.
I used to collect vinyl records, but when the digital age came around.
That's so many vinyl records.
I had the Techniques SL-1200 make twos.
Okay.
They're, I don't know, anyway, it's a famous brand, but they're built like tanks. But yeah, I had quite a lot of fun with those.
That's cool. I just have like a few artists that I like, and then so many from my mom's house.
Yeah.
That she just gave me that probably are all yellowed because she's a smoker.
Oh, no.
But when I got this house, I rent here, and when I got this house, they were asking me, okay, so we need the names of all of the adults that will be living there. And I was like, just me.
Yeah.
I was worried that they would think I was trying to scam them, because you have to pay for all the background checks. So every adult has to have a background check, and they probably were suspicious because I was one person trying to move into like a 4-bedroom house. Technically it's 3-bedroom, but there's a 4th room that has no closet that could be a bedroom if you wanted it to be, but it's like sort of a extra den or something. Anyway, so I told them, like, hey, just so you know, I am going to be living there by myself, and there aren't any other adults, and no kids, no pets, nothing. And then they still came back 2 more times to ask me, what are your children's names? It wasn't even like, do you have minors that will be living with you? Said, what are your children's names? We need the police. And I'm like, what? And then they wanted to know my pets' names, because they had to make sure that there's not any breeds that you're not allowed to have around here.
Okay.
And I'm like, I told you, is it really that unbelievable?
Yeah.
Some weird old lady wants to live in this house by herself,
right, and
karaoke at 3 a.m. So
I would have made up some cool names for that don't exist.
Oh, see, missed opportunity now, but but there probably would have been consequences to, like,
sure,
I don't know.
Okay,
I don't know.
They'll show us their birth certificate.
Right, or I don't know, like, I definitely know that there's a pet deposit. I don't know about a child deposit.
Right.
Seems like they'd be at least in that.
Yeah.
I mean, they shed and barf and poop on the floor.
Yeah, exactly.
I have a nephew, but I don't live near him, so I don't get to have the pleasure of children running around here very often.
Right, yeah.
But I make him little videos that are entertaining, you know.
That's cool.
I just made one this weekend. I wrote in the previous one, I wrote a song about poop for him.
So. Oh, good.
On the ukulele.
Nice.
I'm like the weird old aunt, you know.
Yeah.
Everybody's got to have one. That's my job. It's not exactly the meerkat that runs away to, you know.
Yeah, that's true.
Sacrifice themselves, but you're going to have somebody in your life to write poop songs for the child.
That's right.
My sacrifice. So, anything else before we go ahead and wrap up our funny, silliness, weirdness?
No, I can't really think of much else.
Okay. If commenters want to contact you or anything, will you be able to answer comments or anything like that?
Yeah. So I guess, how do I get those notifications? I don't know. I'll watch it. Just let me know when it comes out. Yeah, I can watch comments.
Yeah.
I know like 90% of the comments happen within a week. So
I think you're right. Yeah.
Please stick around for that. But yeah. I also had my own channel. It was Blue Phoenix Base.
Okay. Yeah, it'll definitely be linked.
Yeah. I haven't made any videos on there, but I made maybe a dozen videos about asexuality. So if anybody wants to check those out, they're welcome to swing by. They're about 3 years old now, I think, this last one. So, oh
God, do I have, I think I have some videos that are like 12 or 13 years old on here.
Really?
Yeah. I think I started making ace videos in 2007.
That is amazing. How many videos do you have?
Oh, I don't know. Okay. God knows. No idea. I mean, most of them are about asexuality, but some of them are just like weird music videos or DDR.
Yeah.
It's the one DDR.
I'm going to look for that.
Yeah, it'll be digging. Very old. But yeah. So if any commenters do want to reach Eric, then, you know, he may be able to respond, and he has his own channel that I will link for everyone.
Yeah. And,
yeah, beyond that, like, gosh, it has been a pleasure having you on this interview, and thanks for volunteering and participating. If anybody listening out there wants to be the next victim, drop a comment.
All you do is you email her.
Email me.
Swankivy at
email. Yeah, it's ivy@swankivy.com.
Just email her and
yeah.
That's, I think you replied within a day, I think.
Yeah, I did, which is a little unusual these days, honestly. If I'm honest, I'm really slow sometimes. But I try. I try to keep up.
Yeah.
Easy as that, y'all.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks for having me.
You are so welcome. And yes, thank you. Thank you. And good night.
Okay. Bye, everybody.